Welcome. Thank you for coming tonight to our Sexuality Series event on male, female, and intersex in the image of God. My name is Julia Smith, and I direct the Sexuality Series here at Calvin College, which is a series of events throughout the school year on topics of sexuality, relationships, and gender from a Christian perspective. We have a few upcoming events, especially for those students among us tonight. Watch out for three events coming in November on sexual assault prevention that are in conjunction with our sexual assault prevention team. And we also, on November 11th, have an afternoon event with our history prof, Kristen Dumay, who will be speaking from her recent book. And that talk is called Purity, Patriarchy, and the First Wave of Christian Anti-Trafficking Activism. Tonight's event is also being live streamed and will be archived on the live stream site. And that's livestream.com/calvincollege/sexualityseries. So you can forward that to friends, neighbors, folks at church, whoever you think might be interested. I would like to thank our co-sponsors for tonight, the Religion Department, Biology Department, Psychology, Gender Studies, the Bruni Counseling Center, Saga, Campus Ministries, and Residence Life for their support. We will be hearing first from Lianne and then from Megan. And following that presentation time, we'll have some Q&A, and folks can come forward to the mics, or we also have a means whereby you can text your question anonymously. But we'll talk about that later. And if you would fill out the evaluation cards that you were handed on the way in and leave them at the door as you exit, that would be great. We will have refreshments in the lobby following this event, and there will also be two book tables there selling Megan and Lianne's books. So I am very privileged to be welcoming Lianne Simon and Megan DeFranza to Calvin College tonight to speak about recovering the knowledge of and a theology of intersex persons. Lianne Simon is a writer and educator about the realities of intersex and is, frankly, one of the most courageous women that I have ever met. Through her blog and her young adult fiction, she raises awareness about conditions such as her own, especially among Christians. Her first novel, Confessions of a Teenage Hermaphrodite, is an authentic portrayal of the issues faced by a child growing up with a sexually ambiguous body. In recent years, Lianne has begun sharing her story publicly in obedience to God's calling on her life and for the sake of others, especially those children who are born between the sexes. And we're also glad to welcome Lianne's husband, John, here. John, glad you could be with us tonight. Megan DeFranza, who will be second up, is a Christian theologian and liberal arts educator. She is the author of Sex Difference in Christian Theology, Male, Female, and Intersex in the Image of God, a thorough, wide-ranging, and nuanced exploration of sex difference placed in conversation with conservative Christian theology. Megan currently serves as a visiting researcher at Boston University's School of Theology and a research associate with the Institute for the Biocultural Study of Religion's Sex Differences Project. That is quite a mouthful. She has taught at Gordon College, Gordon Conwell Seminary, and a range of other seminaries, churches, and conferences around the country. Tonight's event is in many ways a tribute to Calvin College's own Bud Baumer, who passed earlier this year. Bud's work on the topic of intersex was in the realm of biology, obviously. And in an article that he and Heather Loy co-authored in 2005, they noted the dearth of theological reflection on this topic and made an appeal for theologians to do more thorough work in this area. And Megan and Lianne are answering that call. Bud, who served on Megan's PhD dissertation committee, would have been giving this introduction tonight instead of myself, had he not preceded us to glory. But I know that he was thrilled to hear that Megan and Lianne would be speaking at Calvin College today. So please join me in welcoming Lianne Simon and Megan DeFranza.
In 1975, my mother asked me whether I'd be male or female in heaven. She'd recently changed my birth certificate and had seen me gone through a transition period where I lost a lot of the emotional issues that I'd had. I told her that I didn't know and that I wouldn't care because my Redeemer loved me, and I knew that in the resurrection there would still be something recognizable about me and it wouldn't be someone else. Any of you have maybe 16, 18-year-old daughter? You do, okay. Imagine that she's reached that age, she's fairly normal, really healthy, she's on the cheerleading squad, and but she hasn't gotten her period yet. And you've got an honor to go to the gynecologist, a specialist, and she finally goes, and the doctor tells her that she has testes in her abdomen rather than ovaries and uterus, that she has complete androgen insensitivity syndrome. She won't ever be able to have children. And I'm wondering if, can she go and talk to your pastor without him saying, well, you're XY, so that makes you male, rather than female. I'm hoping this will start working again. I guess not. Let's say another one of you is a young married couple, and your newborn looks like a splendid little boy, but the doctors whisk him away and come back and tell you that your daughter has congenital adrenal hyperplasia and that the adrenals are producing more hormones than they should be, or at least resulting in higher androgen levels. And they tell you that she's gonna have to take steroids for the rest of her life, and that any medical treatment, any accident can become a medical emergency. Then they tell you that they want to cut off what looks to you like a penis, and because it's your daughter. And you believe the doctors. You let them go ahead and create a vaginal canal. 10 years, 20 years gone by, and your daughter's happy as a girl. She's got a girlfriend. She's got some very masculine habits, because the same things that virilized her genitals also virilized her brain. Let's say that you've got a different newborn, that the genitals look strange to you. They're very feminine, but there's no vaginal opening. And the doctors tell you that the baby has a condition called mixed gonadal dysgenesis. So the baby has one good testis and one streak ovary, ambiguous genitals, and they tell you you need to raise the child as a girl because there's just not enough tissue there to make her look like a boy. But you go out on the internet and find a support group and find out that most children who have at least one good testis think that they're boys. So you don't let the doctors do that, and you raise the child as a compromise, as a girl, but without surgery. 5 years later, the child's old enough to tell you that they're a boy, but they've got these small feminine genitals, and I'm wondering how your church is going to deal with that, or are you just going to keep it secret from them? I have a condition similar to mixed gonadal dysgenesis. Instead of having one ovary and one testis, I had two gonads that were a combination of tissue that failed. Unfortunately, it also resulted in a number of medical issues that were so serious that my parents, for the first few years, thought that they would lose me. I'm at a little of a loss without the presentation. Thank you. Okay. So I had growth retardation, which you can see I'm not that short, but I was the size of a six-year-old when I was 9 years old, and I just kept growing into my 20s. I have had a bunch of other issues. My face at that age is characteristic of people who have mixed gonadal dysgenesis or Turner syndrome. It comes from having a small jaw, and the lower half of the face is feminized, is what happens. Now, my parents thought I was a boy. I wasn't, but I wasn't a girl either. Being the smallest in my peer group and having the face of an elf, I wondered if maybe I was a changeling, half elf and girl and half human boy. I guess that's what kids do at that age. But most children that have an XY exokaryotype are short for their age, and most remain short throughout their life. Turner syndrome average adult height is like 4'8". My parents went along with the plan in terms of allowing me to play with dolls and play with, I think that's a tea set in my Easter basket. The only line they drew was at letting my hair grow long because they said I looked like a girl. And as long as my health was frail, they kind of ignored what they considered cross-gender behavior. When I was 11, it was the first year that anyone in my classes was shorter than me. Karen Black, we were best of friends. We used to play hopscotch. And my health had improved. I was growing faster. And so my parents decided that it was about time that I started acting more like a boy. One day, the principal at my school came by when I was playing hopscotch with Karen and Linda and said I had to go play with the boys, even though I was much smaller than all of them. But the principal promised that they would teach me the things that boys did, teach me how to play softball, things like that. And I thought, you know, it'd be cool to be a boy. Somehow they convinced me to join their little league team because they were short. And I ended up in the first inning getting knocked down by a ball. And in the outfield, I got hit by a bouncing ball, got a black eye, and my mother put a stop to it quite reasonably. I have spatial issues, so if you throw a ball at me, I'm not going to catch it. It's going to hit me somewhere. I just can't do it. And that's from the same thing as all the medical issues. But there was one boy that, after it was all over, there was one boy who remained my friend, and he asked me over to his house to listen to a brand new musical group called the Beatles. And he sang love songs to me. And I dreamed of marriage and babies. And I begged my parents to let me grow my hair out. Would have been a great time to talk to psychologists about gender, but there really were no options back then. Doctors often didn't tell the parents of intersex children what their children had. They just tell them what to do. And they also made sure that the parents wouldn't tell the children. So all you really get out of that as an intersex child is the knowledge that there's something so horribly wrong about your body that they won't even talk to you about it. And I just got the impression that that was going to be my life. I would never get married. I would never even be intimate with anyone because of my body. High school kind of went downhill, at least until someone had the love and consideration to share the gospel with me. A Southern Baptist mission pastor led me to the Lord, and I assumed that that as a new Christian that, you know, I could get rid of this sin in my life of being feminine and having a feminine body and liking boys, because I was supposed to be one. I hadn't yet really had much in the way of a puberty. But through a lot of my childhood, I thought, you know, if I try hard enough, if I pray hard enough, if I'm good enough, God will make me a real boy. And he didn't, and that was my fault. Or at least I knew it was my fault. So failing at that, I thought, well, the thing to do is to go to a college 1,200 miles away from home, get away from my parents, let my hair grow out, and just figure out who I am. So I did the brilliant thing of leaving a supportive home and going to a boys' dorm. Trust me, if you're not a boy, don't go to a boys' dorm. The boys made it clear that I wasn't one of them. They were abusive. I got propositioned. I had a boy prove that he could do anything he wanted to me. And the school's reaction was to tell me either to take counseling or go home. So I cut my hair really short and bought a motorcycle and managed to nearly kill myself on it, at which point the Lord said, you can either live for me and deal with this or die by your own recklessness. So I went, managed to graduate from college, and immediately went to seek out doctors. At the time, Johns Hopkins was the only program I knew of, and they dealt with both intersex and gender issues. But the person that referred for them told me that I would need several years of counseling before she could refer me, and the first step was to go to a bar in Miami and establish a sexual relationship with a man. Wasn't quite sure why, but I didn't go back. At the time, I was 10 or 2 in my sex development, which is equivalent to like a 9 or 11-year-old boy. So basically nothing, no hair, no muscles. I had depression from the lack of hormones. The doctors were really concerned because my weight was down so far from not eating. And I had serious depression from the lack of hormones because my ovotestes quit and didn't produce any hormones at all. I suspect that I also had bone density issues. I had continued to grow so that my arm span is 2.5 inches more than my height, which because my long bones are longer than they should be, or longer than they would be otherwise. So I probably would have been 5'3", 3.5", had I been on hormones or had a normal puberty. The other issue was that for most of my life, I had been considered defective as male. No one, perhaps with the exception of my father, really believed that I was male. And the close-to-death experience broke me away from trying to please my parents by trying to be a boy. And by that time, I had gotten to where I liked my body, and I didn't want hair and muscles and everything else that I would get taking testosterone. And The doctor, in his wisdom, told me I wouldn't have any trouble from society if I started living as a girl. So I did, and my mother was supportive. My sister thought it was the best thing that had ever happened to me. The estrogen cleared up my anorexia, it cleared up my depression, it closed off my growth, and it helped me in a number of other ways. And I can't stand here and say that I was really strongly gendered to want to be a girl. It was more a defensive maneuver than anything. The first time that I joined a church after that, since I'd been having second thoughts about what I'd done, in terms of I knew I was a girl, but I didn't know that I had the right to be that. And certainly if you ask people in the church, even if you're intersex, they don't really like you changing your legal status from male to female or the other way. But when I explained all my history, the church said, well, you know, you're female in God's eyes. Your body shape is female, and you seem to be female. And the only caveat they gave me was that if I ever married, I'd have to tell my husband before we got married. And then the pastor gave me some advice. He said that I should probably never tell anyone again because people in the church aren't going to be able to handle it. And indeed, I had some long-term friends who, when I shared my history with them, stopped talking to me for the rest of my life. So it can be at least uneven. My current church, I love, we've recently moved away from there, but they recently found out about my blog and asked a bunch of questions. I don't know how they'll react, but I do trust them. I'm hoping they're watching, actually. So I did end up getting married. 2001 was our first anniversary, and I talked to my husband about doing support group work because I had met some families who had children with mixed gonadal dysgenesis who had been castrated and who had had feminizing genital surgeries and who were having gender issues because of it. And it turns out that, as I said, most children who have a good testis and who can process androgens are boys. But we have a medical profession that wants to reinforce a binary view that only male and female were ever created, that there's nothing else. So they need to get rid of it by reshaping genitals, castration, giving hormones, and through secrecy and outright lies. I've had a few friends who have complete androgen insensitivity syndrome. They have testes in their abdomen, and they were told that they had twisted ovaries that needed to come out. The reason they need to come out is that they said it was cancer, but there's only a 5% chance of getting cancer, gonadal cancer in AIS. Approximately 5%. Same risk of getting breast cancer, but they don't cut off the breasts just because you might, 5% get cancer. So the question is, how's the church going to treat these sort of cases? You know, can I go into a church and be open about my condition? Do I have to keep secret? I haven't told anyone. I've told one person at the church that we're members of right now, simply because I don't know how they'll react. If you take all of the diversity of biological sex and reduce it to looking at one parameter, at least with intersex, you're going to continue to run into exceptions to that, and you're going to be just flat out wrong. So I'm going to leave you with a quote from C.S. Lewis that wasn't addressed at intersex, but certainly applies. I'll let you read it because I can't see it from here. Thank you. Thank you for coming.
Good evening. Thank you for coming. And thank you, Calvin, for the invitation, and especially Julia, who's our tech support, as well as invitation here. I don't come to you as an intersex woman, but as a Christian woman, a Christian theologian. I grew up in a very conservative corner of the evangelical Midwest. I come from, I'm a granddaughter of colonial missionaries. My grandparents were missionaries in the Belgian Congo. It's where my dad grew up. And I grew up in a conservative church where women didn't even pass the offering plate, much less get up behind the pulpit. But I wanted to serve the Lord. And that was fine when I was in high school and the president of FCA, Fellowship of Christian Athletes, at my public school. But when I went off to Bible college, I started getting some mixed messages. One of my professors said if I grew up to be a theologian and taught adult men at the college level, I would be violating 1 Timothy 2 and sinning. And one of my other professors said, Megan, why don't you go get your PhD and come back and be the first woman in our Bible and theology department. So I had to go to seminary and figure out which of these men were right and how I was going to serve the Lord, because I didn't want to sin while trying to serve God. And so I started into gender studies and theology, but it wasn't until my doctoral work that I learned about intersex in some of my research, actually on transgender. And I wondered, why have I never heard of this before? It took a long time to figure out where I was going. So that's how I got here. But as a theologian, I have to ask, how do I think about intersex? How should we think about intersex as Christians? I know Genesis 1 and 2 as well as you do. That says God created humankind in God's image, male and female. And Genesis 2, the man says, this at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. This one shall be called woman, for out of man this one was taken. It's for this reason a man leaves his father and mother and clings to his wife, and they become one flesh. I didn't see any space in these texts for people who didn't fit the male-female paradigm. But I kept reading, because the Bible's a big book. And to my surprise, I did find evidence of intersex in the Bible. And not just anywhere, actually in the words of Jesus in Matthew chapter 19. In Matthew, Jesus is responding to a question from some Pharisees who actually want him to weigh in on a rabbinic debate going on at the time. They asked him, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for any and every reason? She burns the toast, can you give her a divorce certificate? Jesus answered, haven't you read that the one who made them in the beginning made them male and female? And said, for this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. He quotes Genesis 1 and Genesis 2. So they're no longer two, but one flesh. What God has joined together, let no one separate. And the disciples said, if we can't get out of this, maybe it's just better not to marry. In a culture where somebody else picks your spouse and you don't have an escape clause, they didn't think this was a good idea. But Jesus doesn't validate their instinct. He says, not everyone can accept this statement, but only those to whom it's given. For there are eunuchs who have been so from birth, and there are eunuchs who've been made eunuchs by others, and there are eunuchs who have made themselves eunuchs for the sake of the kingdom of heaven. Let anyone accept this who can. This is a very literal translation of the Greek. Some of our English translations they make some what's called dynamic equivalence, some interpretive choices. But this is the literal interpretation of the Greek in Matthew 19. Now, I'd read this passage numerous times growing up, and I breezed right by it. I knew a little bit about the second type of eunuchs, some a little vague and kind of scary information about castration. And I knew that the third type of eunuch was connected with monks and nuns and their choices, but I didn't know anything about this first type of eunuch. I'd never heard any teaching on it. But I learned that Jesus is actually working with some rabbinic categories here. When he says eunuchs who've been so from birth, he's talking about what the rabbis called the saris chama, or eunuchs of the sun, meaning from the first day that the sun shone upon this child, they knew that something was different. You see, when circumcision is the sign of inclusion in your community, rabbis get pretty good at identifying when things look different under the hood. The rabbis actually ended up coming up with six different terms for different bodily or genital formations that they encountered. Saris Chama was one of those. The point is, ancient Jews and Christians knew that the categories of male and female were not enough. The rabbis knew Genesis 1 and 2 just as well as we do, if not more so. And yet, as they encountered different kinds of bodies in the world, they came up with additional language to talk about those who didn't fit neatly into these two categories. And it wasn't just Jews who knew about differences of sex development. The ancient Christians did as well. Here's Augustine writing in The City of God, which many of us have read. I wonder if you ever noticed this passage. As for androgynes, also called hermaphrodites, they're certainly very rare, and yet it is difficult to find periods where there are no examples of human beings possessing the characteristics of both sexes, in such a way that it is a matter of doubt how they should be classified. However, the prevalent usage has called them masculine, assigning them to the better sex. It's classic Augustine, you love him and hate him in the same passage. Yeah. Augustine was willing to include hermaphrodites, or androgynes, under the category of the male. But he wasn't so generous to eunuchs. Elsewhere in The City of God, he says that a castrated eunuch is neither changed into a woman nor allowed to remain a man. One 4th century Roman poet said, "Eunuchs are exiles from the society of the human race, belonging neither to one sex nor the other." While the ancients were more familiar with differences of sex development than some of us, that didn't mean it was easy to be different in the ancient world. Certainly, if you were a castrated eunuch in ancient Israel, you couldn't go to church. You couldn't go to worship at the assembly, according to Deuteronomy 23:1. However, the saris chama, the naturally born eunuchs, were allowed to go to worship. The rabbis pulled from the laws for men and the laws for women so that they could create religious laws for naturally born eunuchs in their culture. Contemporary Jewish scholars do the same thing today. So I began to wonder, if ancient Jews and Christians could make space for people who are born with differences of sex development, legally and religiously, why can't we? If ancient Jews saw no problem adding to the categories of male and female, could we Christians follow their example? So I began to look back at the creation accounts in Genesis, and I noticed some things. There's this pattern going on in Genesis chapter 1, pattern of separation, separating the light from the darkness, the waters above from the waters below, humankind into male and female, the creatures into creatures of the sky, creatures of the land, creatures of the sea. Broad categories of creation. But I noticed that some things were missing in this account. There's no mention of rivers, or comets, or dawn, or dusk, or amphibians. There's no mention of any creatures that inhabit more than one category. Amphibians are creatures of the water and creatures of the land. They're not mentioned in Genesis chapter 1. But you know, I've never heard a scientist who's a Christian say, those amphibians, they're a result of the fall. Because they mix two of God's clear categories of creation. Of course, they're proof of the fall. I've never heard anybody say that. But when Christians learn about intersex, you know, the first thing they say to me, well, the fall, it messed up God's plan. Because God wanted male and female, two categories. But I thought, we're not really being consistent here in our interpretation of Genesis. It doesn't look like it's an exhaustive catalog of all of God's creation. The narrator is speaking in general terms, broad categories. So I began to ask myself, what if we read Genesis differently? What if Adam and Eve are not the pattern, but the parents in the narrative? What if instead of looking at Adam and Eve as God's best, we read this story as the beginning of a good creation that goes south and God's redeeming and working? What if instead of reading them as the exclusive model of how all Christians should be, we read them as the statistical majority? Is it possible to read Genesis differently? The beginning, parents of kids who would be different from them. And as the story develops, not just their family, but other families, other tribes, other languages, other peoples, and even differently sexed human beings come into the story of God's great work. Do Adam and Eve represent the ideal form of masculinity into which we all must conform? Or are they the fountainheads of the beautiful variety of human beings who were to come after them? Because as we look around us, it seems like diversity is not the exception. It seems more like the rule. And science certainly tells us this. This is from Dr. Hines, the director of neuroendocrinology, this research lab in London, where they study sex differences. They study intersex, they study the non-intersex, they study behavior patterns, and try to say how different are men and women in statistical, in shape rotation, in math skills, in linguistic development, in aggression. You know, all of these things that we talk about as differences between the sexes, they try to measure them. And so she says in her book, after doing all of this research, actually this comes from the introduction, she says it later too, that few, if any, individuals correspond to the modal male pattern or the modal female pattern, mode meaning the statistical majority. Variation within each sex is great, with males and females near the top and bottom of distributions for every characteristic. In fact, although most of us appear to be either clearly male or clearly female, we are each complex mosaics of male and female characteristics. Is all of this diversity a result of the fall? Or was this God's plan all along? The Bible doesn't really tell us one way or another. It doesn't say yes, it doesn't say no. What we have are plausible interpretations that we need to weigh. So I asked myself, in the scope of Christian theology, in the way that we read the whole Bible, is the story one of beginning in Eden, a fall and a return? Is it a circular story? Or is it a linear story? Are we supposed to get back to Eden, where there's no diversity other than male and female, where there are no hybrid creatures, where there are no racial differentiations or linguistic differences, no different people groups? Or, when it comes to new creation, are we looking at something different? Echoes of Eden, but something more. I think if we look in the book of Revelation, we find some evidence that the eschaton will not just be a return to Eden. It will echo it, but carry on to something new. Because some of the diversity that we get not in Eden, but in the rest of the story, shows up at the end, where a great multitude from every nation, tribe, people, and language are standing and kneeling and prostrate before the Lamb in worship. Differences that don't exist at the beginning are taken up and redeemed in the end. What happens when we see human diversity not as a problem? What if intersex people can come as they are? Can we do that? I think there's evidence from the scriptures that we can, some that I've just shared with you. But there are other places too. This is one of my favorite passages now. This is Isaiah chapter 56. You see, like I said, it wasn't easy to be a eunuch in ancient Israel, right? You can't go to church if you're castrated, can't go to the assembly. You're an outsider. Many eunuchs and foreigners, though they were excluded from worship in Israel, they still wanted to be a part of God's people. But they're like, you know, God, it's not easy. So they start complaining. And God, in his graciousness, hears them and speaks to them through the prophet Isaiah and says, "Don't let the foreigner join to the Lord say, 'The Lord will surely separate me from his people.' And don't let the eunuch say, 'I'm just a dry tree.' For thus says the Lord, to the eunuchs who keep my Sabbath, who choose the things that please me and hold fast to my covenant, I will give in my house and within my walls a monument and a name better than sons and daughters. I will give them an everlasting name that will not be cut off." Even God isn't above puns. Notice the blessing. The blessing is not, "I will heal you, eunuchs, and restore you to my creational intent of being a man, so that you can be a good Jewish boy like every other Jewish boy and carry on your name by having sons." That is not the blessing. "I will give you something better than sons and daughters, an everlasting name as you are." And to the foreigners, like us Gentiles, who join themselves to the Lord, who love the Lord and are his servants and keep Sabbath and don't profane it and hold to the covenant, "These also I will bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house shall be a house of prayer for all people." Can I get an amen? I've seen that last verse a lot, quoted out of context. Never heard a preacher preach on the eunuch part. Have you? No. Sometimes we don't do a good job preaching on things that make us uncomfortable. Of course, Isaiah did not see this prophecy fulfilled, but we do. because we have the book of Acts. The book of Acts records the gospel going from the Jews to the Samaritans to the utter ends of the world, to the Gentiles. This is the recording that we see in Acts. The Spirit falls at numerous occasions to confirm that God is bringing in those who have been separated. And Philip is called to go down to this road that goes from Jerusalem to Gaza. So Philip goes. And there's an Ethiopian eunuch who had traveled hundreds of miles from Ethiopia to go worship at a place where he cannot go past the court of the Gentiles, and he cannot go into the court of men. And he's going anyway. And he's coming home, and he's reading what book? The prophet Isaiah. And Philip starts sharing with him the gospel, starting from this passage in Isaiah, proclaiming the good news about Jesus. And they come to water. And the eunuch says, look, here's water. What is to prevent me from being baptized? I never understood the significance of that question until I learned about eunuchs. There's a lot that could prevent him. He wants to know, if I follow this Jewish rabbi named Yeshua, am I still going to be a second-class citizen? Can I go to church like everybody else? Or am I still going to be on the outside because I'm different? I don't know what Philip said to him. It's not recorded. Sometimes I wonder if he said something like Paul says to the Galatians, that when you're baptized into Christ, you're clothed with Christ, where there's no longer Jew or Greek, Jew or Gentile, Jew or Ethiopian, where there's no longer slave or free. Many eunuchs were slaves. This is a slave to the queen of Candace, a high-ranking slave, but a slave. There's no longer male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. You belong to Christ, so then you are Abraham's offspring and heirs according to the promise. I don't know what Philip said, but somebody commanded the chariot to stop, and they both went down into the water. We have no record of Philip healing the Ethiopian eunuch. We have no record of Jesus ever healing a eunuch. He healed a lot of people who were outsiders. The woman with the issue of blood who was unclean. He raised the dead. Can't get more outside the community than that. But he never healed a eunuch. What if God is doing something new? I think God was doing something new, and I think we're being given the opportunity to do something new as well. If God can welcome people with sex differences, can we? I hope so.
So we have been given much, much to think about here. There's a question mark. Oh. Oh, okay, we're going to skip through. Oh, nope. I need this last one here. Okay. So there are two ways that we can ask the questions here. And Megan and Lianne, if you would like to come up and, I don't know, you can grab a stool each if you want. We can do that. So feel free to come to one of these mics. I will put mine back on this stand in a minute. Or if you would rather text your question, then just text the word Calvin to that number 22333, and it will say, yes, you have joined the poll. And then you can text your question, and it will come up on my iPad, and I'll be able to ask it. So we can move, we can just, I would put it on the floor.
Okay.
We are high tech at Calvin College. So please, don't be shy. Let's have some questions.
Easy.
So can we move from the lessons of intersex to trans? Can the things we're saying about intersex apply to people who are trans?
Right. Great question. What's the connection between intersex and transgender? Some trans persons connect with the second type of eunuch, the castrated eunuch, because their bodies are being changed. They're choosing to change their bodies. We need to be careful bringing those together because most people were castrated against their will. Often slaves were castrated so they could be more useful to the aristocracy. It was actually outlawed in Rome to castrate people, so they imported them from the East. They were really expensive. But at the same time, there were some Christians who castrated themselves. Origen was one of them. And some people speculated that Origen castrated himself because he wanted to protect himself from slander, because he was one of the few theologians who was willing to have female as well as male disciples. I actually have a quote here in my notes from an early Christian scholar named Peter Brown. And let's see if I can find it on, on Origen. And he says that Origen was trying to do something more, that Origen was convinced that sex differences were things that would be passing away. And so he wanted to testify in his body to the kind of life we would live in heaven, beyond sex and gender, where we would be like the angels. So there is some history here with self-castration or voluntary castration and questioning the gender binary for theological reasons, right? Now that's not all transgender people there. Some Christians have trouble with transgender because we can't point to biological phenomena, but that may not always be the case. I wouldn't be surprised if transgender gets folded under the intersex umbrella 10, 15 years ago when we know more about the science of gender identity development. We do know that gender identity is influenced by hormones. Just because we can't point to something in the gonads, there might be something happening in the brain. So I do think it's they're closely related. Here, and it's worth thinking about that this inclusion of others can extend to the trans community as well. Do you want to comment on that, Leah?
No, I'm fine.
Oh, Leanne, you shared a lot tonight, and I really appreciate it. Takes an extreme amount of courage, and I really thank you for that. I just had another personal question, and if it's too personal, by no means, you don't have to share it, but like, when you met your husband and dating with him, like, did you encounter additional stress with that, and how was he with learning about your past?
I was terrified of sharing my history with anyone, actually. But as I shared lesser things with him, he reacted positively. And I educated him on intersex and then decided to just write a long email that disclosed everything I'd ever been afraid of sharing with anyone. And after he received it, he called me and said he cried. And that our relationship at that point went shortly thereafter to marriage. He claimed that his diabetes would be more of an issue in our marriage than my intersex, and that has turned out to be true.
Question here. What is the data about the number of people as a percent who are born intersex? Am I correct to assume that Megan is saying that these individuals are more... Whoops. Okay. I think it cut off at that point. So the percent of intersex.
Percentage of intersex people. That's really a political question rather than a medical question. People argue over which conditions to include, and you have conditions like Turner syndrome, which under its original definition only happened with women or with females. But I could have, with the karyotype I have, been born with all of the issues of Turner syndrome, because my karyotype's the same as some women who have Turner syndrome. And that's 46XY/45X. Some of my cells have a Y chromosome and some don't. So if a Turner syndrome woman has a Y chromosome in some of her cells, to me that makes her intersex. But the Turner Syndrome Society would argue vehemently against it. Some people will say you should include Klinefelter's, some say you shouldn't. Some say you should even include things like polycystic ovarian syndrome. So the numbers that they throw around for the most part are 1 in 2,000, but if you look into the history of that number, there's not much to substantiate it. So we really don't know. I would say probably 1 in 2,000 is a good guess.
Somebody else is asking, are all intersexed individuals unable to bear children?
No. Women with congenital adrenal hyperplasia can have ambiguous genitals, and still, if their hormones are under control, they can bear children. And with some of the latest technology, women with partial androgen insensitivity syndrome may be able to father children, even though they're close to being female externally. They can still, there's an argument over whether they can do it, but they may be able to extract sperm precursors from gonadal biopsies and use ICSI to fertilize an egg. But the general rule is for Turner syndrome, unless they're mosaic, they're not going to be fertile because they don't have ovaries. Swyer syndrome, don't have ovaries. Complete androgen insensitivity, they have testes, but they're probably not fertile in the testes. Klinefelter has reduced fertility. It's all about where you draw the lines in intersex. I mean, even individual cases, you go, well, are they really just less masculine? Are they mixed? You know, if a woman starts growing facial hair, does that make her intersex? I mean, where do you draw the lines?
Two questions. One. We kept on talking about the complications on creating categories for these. Is your general understanding that the intersex community wants to even find categories for these? Do they want to almost stay pretty fluid about this because it's so complicated? So that's one question. Second question. So I'm pretty zazzed up about this. And coming from a conservative background myself, I can only imagine how difficult this conversation would be to have. What is your advice to people if you're attending either more progressive or conservative, whatever those binaries mean? What's your advice to people introducing this topic, if it is pretty foreign, which I imagine it is, to the majority, to a congregation? Is that something that should be done swiftly, and does it need to be addressed? Or do you say that something's slow and needs to be careful about it because the congregation could, whether that's backlash or not, I don't know. So, two questions.
You want to answer the first, and I'll answer the second.
You want to repeat the first? I am nearly deaf in one ear, so.
Yeah, I was just saying, because the I don't want to call it issue, I don't know what you guys, the complications of intersex, does the intersex community want these categories not so specific on purpose? So we keep on saying, who's lumped in, who's lumped out? Do we want to even do that because it's so complicated? Do we want to keep it fluid, or does the intersex community want to create some actual standards that we can put on in a cat, I don't know, somewhere?
What I think is of general interest to the intersex community, and there's certainly not unanimity, is first of all bodily integrity, so that, you know, we're not cut up as little kids, and that we're not given hormones unless there's informed consent. Basically, don't make the fact that someone has either ambiguous genitals or something else, don't make that a medical condition. Don't force it to be treated as something that is broken. And certainly don't apply treatments that involve forcing the binary. As far as where to draw the lines, if you don't base it in terms of medical diagnoses, it makes it rather difficult to draw lines, because then anyone who says, I'm intersex because I'm intersex, is in. I mean, you know, we don't generally ask for a karyotype from someone or look to see what's between their legs, see if they have scars. So you have to pretty much trust who people say they are. As far as drawing the lines, we probably tend to draw the lines wider than the doctors do, or certainly wider than a lot of the parents do. In the case of Turner syndrome, the parents are probably the main reason that they don't want them labeled as intersex. You know, they don't even really want them labeled as a difference of sex development, which is fine, I understand. I think most of us just want to be left to live our lives and to choose to live as male or female or not. And the second question?
Yeah, as far as how to educate the church, I have a little experience with this. A number of my friends are pastors, and they've been hearing me talk about this for quite a few years now. And so one of my friends, who's a pastor in the Bible Belt, called me up. He's like, okay, Megan, I'm coming up on Matthew 19 in the lectionary. Help me out. And we talked, and I explained the history of eunuchs, and I sent him some stuff, and he preached on it. He educated his church through the scripture that was the next step to be read. He didn't need a special program. He just preached the Bible.
Amen.
I had another pastor this year who told me that shortly after Easter, it was Acts 8 that was coming up on the lectionary. My book was out at that point, so I said, read chapter 2. And he did. And it changed the way he preached on Acts chapter 8 about the Ethiopian eunuch. So we have resources. We don't have to make a special program, but we need not to be afraid, and we need to do our homework so that we can talk to the church about people as they really are and not these ideal categories that we've created.
Two questions for Megan, and one is, you have crossed many lines. One of them is to be female and to be a theologian and to help other male people understand the Bible. How has that been accepted in the circles that you came from originally? Mm-hmm. Do you still have people who are opposed to you being female and being in this position? The second question is, what parallels might there be here for the LGBT issue that's facing the mm-hmm. church today, that we may not be looking at biological things that we understand today, mm-hmm. but maybe those will come someday. Mm-hmm. Do you take a position there that says the church ought to be open here mm-hmm. as with intersex? They should be with gay and lesbian relationships.
Right. Thanks. I haven't run into many people who are all concerned about me being a professor of theology, thankfully. I do have family members and friends from my youth, from the conservative corner of the evangelical world in which I grew up, who think it's a little weird and aren't on board when I preach at a church when I'm invited to do that. But they don't give me too much grief. They just think I'm a little weird and outside the boundaries. They blame that on me living in Massachusetts. So as for the connection between intersex, we've already talked a little about the connection between intersex and trans, and then everybody always wants to know, how is this connected to our current debate over sexual ethics? And I have to tell you, when I started this research, I thought sex was simple and the Bible was clear. And then I learned that sex is not so simple, but I still thought the Bible was clear on marriage, on certain homosexual acts that are forbidden in certain texts in the scriptures. And then I started studying those texts, and I realized that they were not as clear as I thought they were, as they'd been taught to me, that Sodom and Gomorrah has absolutely nothing to do with our current conversation about same-sex marriage. Gang rape is not the same as consensual monogamy, right? That's pretty basic. And that some of these other passages, you know, there are questions about how to interpret them. And so I've been drawn on a journey myself. I don't think you can move from intersex to say, oh, gender is just a spectrum and it's all good. I think that's sloppy thinking and sloppy exegesis. But I know for me, realizing that sex development is complicated and that there is a spectrum. And I think the science is already pointing to the influence of biology on sexual orientation. Certainly with congenital adrenal hyperplasia, with higher levels of androgens, in XX females, there's significantly higher percentage who identify as lesbian. Do we think that's an accident? I don't think so. We can't do these experiments on human beings. It's unethical. But intersex gives us some natural experiments in some ways about, well, if we change these hormone levels, we know with rats, if we change their hormone levels, we change their sexual activity. And the biologists tell me that rats are not that different from humans. If we look at the genetics, I know that's a little hard to swallow, but that's what my biology friends tell me. So we're already seeing the connection between biology and sexual orientation. We know it's not a choice, right? For very few people is this a choice. So I think it's important for us to ask those questions, to look at the complexity, and to do the hard work of looking at those scriptures. So I came on a path that I didn't expect to be on, to come to a welcoming place. But it took not just studying the biology, it took listening to people's stories, it took studying those passages that are separate from the passages that are connected to intersex. But it certainly gave me some ground to stand on. Now, some people would say, you don't want to learn about intersex because you're going to end up here. It's the slippery slope, right? And there are a lot of conservatives who don't want me to talk to you or Lianne to talk to you about intersex because it's going to complicate the conversation. But the truth of the matter is it's a complicated conversation. So we need to be adults and do the hard work and have the conversation.
All right, thank you.
Yeah.
There's another question texted by somebody asking about what parents should do if they have a child who's born with an intersex condition.
The support groups recommend several different things. The main thing is to protect the child from unnecessary medical interventions, to preserve their options for later in life when they can participate in the decisions. And there's also no reason for most intersex children to be undergoing regular pelvic exams, that sort of thing. It's simply not necessary medically, you know, unless there's an issue with urinary tract infections or something.
So I have a follow-up question. That sounds kind of easy. You just make sure the kid is able to preserve choices for later on. Is it actually easy in relationship to the medical profession?
What makes it relatively easy is finding a support group and finding out what other parents are doing and finding out how their children have been hurt by mistreatment. It's part of the problem is when you have an intersex child, you have to become the advocate. You have to know more than the doctors, because a typical doctor may not have more than one intersex patient in his career. And there aren't that many centers around the U.S. that have experts. I don't know of any that are treating adults. I mean, okay, there are some that are treating adults, but they're not set up to be treating adults. They're pediatric centers that allow adults to go.
You talk about preserving choice for the folks later. Is that typically an easy choice for them, in the sense of easy if all the junk of society were not out there? Do most intersex really strongly, given that choice, identify a gender one way or the other? Or do most intersex kind of have this, dysphoria is really the right word, but I think you know what I'm getting at.
A lot of the intersex conditions, a lot of them have fairly predictable gender outcomes. Okay. There are some that don't, like the one I've got is fairly unpredictable, but you can make an educated guess or even an intuitive decision and say, I'm going to raise the child as a girl, mm-hmm. because that's what seems to be closest. Mm-hmm. And best suited for that condition, and then just be in a position where you're educating the child about their condition, mm-hmm. as they can understand it, and getting their feedback, because 3 years old, 5 years old, you'll start to see what gender they mm-hmm. are looking like. And it's not, you don't say, oh, aha, boy, you're going to be a boy. Just cut them some slack too, because mm-hmm. nowadays it seems like a child that's maybe 5 years old who has gender issues is going to get diagnosed as transgender, and then they're in this track of treatment that they can't get out of that easily. Mm-hmm. So, just let them be kids.
Thanks.
I have a friend texting me questions to ask, so I'll just. I think this is one about maybe blurring those lines. So she says, and she's a biologist, if 46XY and 46XX are the norm, then are others pathological, or is it just diversity? Mm-hmm. I don't know if there's an answer to that.
It's a great question. Who's going to say? We don't have God weighing in on this conversation. We have the scriptures. We're trying to interpret them carefully, faithfully, reasonably. We're trying to bring them into conversation with science. We're also trying to listen to the people who are most affected by these differences. And many of them are saying what Lianne's been telling you, you know, we're okay. Our bodies are okay for the most part. Very few kinds of intersex have medical complications. It's society that's the problem, right? So I think those are the voices we need to listen to most, rather than me as a cisgender, non-intersex female making a judgment for this community. You know, I think we need to be listeners and let them tell us. And you know, some will seek medical intervention of their own choice, and some may not. Yeah. So there, it's not a uniform opinion even across the intersex community. But I think we're learning a lot from other conversations, from disability conversations. We're learning about ableism from feminist conversations. We're learning about misogyny. You know, we see how the people most affected by some of these choices need to be at the table making as part of these conversations. But the problem is physicians have been making a lot of these decisions, and now the community is rising up and trying to change those medical protocols.
My understanding is that blue eyes are a genetic mutation, and according to people who believe in evolutionary theory, that they're rather recent genetic mutations, so they probably weren't in the garden. Certainly not all eye colors are in the garden, unless they were both heterochromatic, and we are not. So I haven't heard anybody lately say that blue eyes or ginger hair are in any way bad. So the question is the diversity of intersex a problem even? I mean, I understand that some of the conditions result in a lack of fertility, but I'm not sure that fertility's at the root of our sexual differences. It's certainly involved.
I think we also need to be attentive to our history. I mean, for a long time, lefties were considered a result of the fall. I mean, if you look at the Latin for sinistra, sinister is the left side, right? My father-in-law, who is still alive, the nuns whacked him on the left hand. Right, you're not supposed to write with your left hand. It's wrong. It's not how God has made us. Right? We don't do that anymore. You know, we're learning that there are minority occurrences in lots of fields, right? Left-handedness is 10% of the world population. Red hair is 1% of the world population. Is it a problem? So we're starting to change the way we think about minority experiences, and I think that's a good thing.
Please. I'm channeling my biologist friend here, who would point out that the geologic record that goes back millions of years shows genetic variation that would account for such things as blue eyes. I love the idea, though, kind of, that blue eyes are a result of the fall, just because it would be so to throw that in the face of so many people that I know.
Blonde hair?
Yeah, too. I totally reject it, but nevertheless, it might be convenient. I am a gender studies theorist and also a race theorist, and what I teach my students is that if you want to see how society defines itself and defines its categories, look at the things that don't fit into a category. And so, of course, intersex, transgender individuals, they don't fall into our categories. And so my question for you, for Megan and for Lianne, is how has your investment, your study in people that do not fall into the categories, what have you learned from that about how society defines male and female?
Go ahead.
Trying to think if I understand your question. It is a 40,000 foot question. I think it's fascinating to watch how societies have defined masculinity and femininity cross-culturally in our own time and historically. Certainly as a church historian, I'm very interested in how masculinity and femininity were constructed in the ancient world and how different that is from today. Masculinity was considered, men were the ones who had self-control. The hardness of their bodies was evidence of the strength of their soul. And women were the ones who didn't have any self-control because their bodies were soft. Now we say, well, boys don't have any self-control because of testosterone, and boys will be boys. Isn't it fascinating how we keep looking to the body to tell us how we should live or what we can let go of? So as far as what it has told me about femininity and masculinity, I think just learning about the diversity among men and women has been so helpful. I don't think this information is just good news for intersex folks. I think it's good news for me. That I don't have to try and fit myself into some feminine ideal that we're projecting onto Eve in the garden. That's liberating. I can be me, 5'2", maybe, on my license anyway. And it's not a problem. I can be a theologian, even though I was, you know, I was a philosophy major and there were two other women in my program, right? I don't have to worry about that. That there's some, I thought that maybe there was something wrong with me when I was in college because I was interested in philosophy and theology and ministry, and I looked around and there were only men in the room. And I asked the Lord in prayer, did you mean to make me a woman? Because it'd be a whole lot easier if I wasn't. So I think there's lots that we can learn. And a lot of work we need to do in the way we preach and the way we teach in churches, we so often go to the stereotypes when instead of talking about people as they really are in the world. If we can change that, I think we can make some progress.
I've been fascinated by how we got here. Intersex treatment protocols, in this country at least, were largely begun at Johns Hopkins by Dr. John Money. And he didn't believe exclusively in nurture as far as gender went, but the feminists who latched onto his studies certainly promoted that concept as being beneficial to feminism. And the church certainly has bought into the concept that gender is entirely nurture. Whereas I wonder if it's not part of the image of God within us that is a wonderful gift rather than something that we learn over our lifetime. Certainly our experiences contribute to who we are, but in intersex, there are a number of conditions where it's fairly clear that you can't just surgically feminize a child and expect them to grow up thinking of themselves as a girl. So, a little disappointed actually how often the church gloms onto popular science as though it were scripture.
If anyone wants to ask a final question, come now. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, I will provide one. Mm-hmm. All right. I'd like to give a two-parter. And hopefully this will sum up a few of the questions that I've received, too. So how do we ascertain what part of so creation as we know it can be assigned to the fall? So people are asking, you know, maybe if intersex isn't part of the fall, then can we say transgender is or homosexual, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think the deeper question is, how do we ascertain what is part of the fall and what is a creational norm? And then to finish on a hopeful note, I would just like you both to reflect on what hope you see for the church in regards to intersex.
The question question of the fall is a hard one. I'd ask right back to somebody who's asking me, how do we know? Right, the Bible doesn't tell us, okay, the fall happens and we have this. Adam and Eve are told, on the day that you eat of it, you will surely die. They didn't die. It's funny because the serpent said, you will not surely die. The serpent was actually right, literally. And so theologians have often interpreted that metaphorically, spiritual death, right? We've left behind the Greek idea that humans are naturally immortal and that mortality, that's not a Hebrew idea at all. That came in with the Greeks. So we don't think that it's natural death, and the biologists will tell us that there was death in the garden. There's death all day long of cells and microorganisms, that it's not physical death that the scriptures are talking, but it's spiritual death, right? Which is then, Paul preaches, you know, you were dead in your sins, and now you are alive in Christ. We don't have any evidence from the Bible of that certain things are assigned to the fall. We have no guidance from scripture. So it's not something that we can say, but I think we need to learn from our past mistakes, right? It's kind of like the God of the gaps theory, right? We don't know how creation came about, so we're going to say, well, God did that, you know, or then we see things that don't seem to fit. We're like, oh, the fall, right? Left-handedness, intersex, right? How do we know? We don't. But I think we need to have these thoughtful conversations about what would happen if we think about this particular phenomena through the lens of the fall. What's the result of that? Is that going to hurt people? Is that going to help people? So I think it's a challenging conversation, but I think anybody who says, oh yeah, I know, they don't know, right? We can speculate, we can make educated recommendations, but I think we need to do them with fear and trepidation about the consequences of assigning certain things to the fall.
I'm not sure that it's the right question to be asking. There are certainly a lot of good things that are here that weren't in the garden. And rather than try to split them up into good and bad, God has extended his grace marvelously since the fall. Otherwise, we'd all be dead. And he has made the gospel clear to the world. And I understand that the gospel was the original plan, but you don't see a lot of it in the garden. As far as hopeful, the rise of support groups on the internet has been the bane of some doctors because they can no longer tell parents and expect them to actually listen. What they hear is what's happened to other families. So we're communicating better, and eventually it'll work its way into the church, but it's only going to happen through prayer and through evangelism. And, you know, because I can walk in and say, my body's not completely male or female, I'm going to educate you, and I'll get kicked out because I'll say, there's only male and female, until they're ready to at least listen. And what I've found most effective is one-on-one communication. After I've known the person for 5 years, I may tell them more until finally they know enough that they know me first instead of intersex me first. Mm-hmm. Because the intersex me first isn't nearly as close to knowing me as just knowing me.
I'm hopeful. Because a lot of people say, you're going to talk to what church? What college? They really want you to come and talk about that? I've had other conferences where people have tried to get me off of panels and say there's nothing we can learn from the intersexed, and she's got to have a covert agenda. But then when people actually hear me, like you, and they find out that intersex is not something new under the sun, that we have evidence of it in the scriptures and history from the mouth of Jesus throughout church history, I think it gives us some ground to stand on, to think that we're not the first ones to have to wrestle with this. This isn't something that's a result of the sexual revolution. I hear that a lot. No, it's really not. It's been around a long time. But what I'm encouraged about is people who are nervous when they hear me say intersex and they don't know what that is and they're nervous about it because it's got the word sex in it. Once they hear a little more, they're pretty receptive. I've been in some really conservative places where people have been really receptive. I was invited to a women's Bible study at my church with these ladies who are between 60 and 90 knitting there, you know. And I got done sharing with them about this work, and they said, what can we do to be more inclusive as a church? So don't tell me it's just the young people who have open minds. You know, I'm encouraged by people who want to learn and want to follow in the steps of Jesus. I mean, when Jesus talked about eunuchs, he didn't talk about them the way rabbis did. Rabbis made fun of eunuchs because their beards were really thin and lots of other differences. Jesus didn't do that. He says, make yourself like a eunuch for the kingdom of heaven. Make yourself like an outcast from the society of the human race for the kingdom of heaven. Make yourself like someone who doesn't fit into the category of male or female for the kingdom of heaven. You know how radical that is? He takes this group of people who are marginalized and on the outside and raises them up as a model for Christian discipleship, which is just like Jesus, right? So I think if we can just ask, what would Jesus do? What did he do? I think there's hope for the rest of us. So, yeah.
Wonderful. Well, thank you again so much. Please join me in thanking Megan and Lianne. And they'll be around here afterwards to take some more questions. And we have the book tables in the lobby. Thank you for coming.
If there are books left out there, they are a gift to you.
We did want to say one more thing to you. I don't know. How do I make this go back? Yeah.
Yeah, that was it.
Oh, I missed it. Here we go. Nope. That one.
Forward now.
Yes. There we go. We think that these stories are important, but not everybody is going to be able to invite Lianne to their church. And so one of the things that we're starting is a documentary project to share Lianne's story and the story of other intersex persons of faith, other intersex Christians, and possibly an intersex Jew who have agreed to work with us. But documentaries are kind of expensive. And so if you would like to support this work, keep an eye out. There's a donation jar out front if you want to contribute now. If you want to keep track of us, you can both follow us both on our blogs, LianneSimon.com, MeganDeFranza.com, and you can keep track of the work that we're doing. But if you want to help us get these stories out to a wider audience, we do think that a documentary would be a helpful way to do that. So know about that too.